Hello, and welcome to this week's History and Context podcast. We've been discussing Cobbett and Dickens as part of the journalism course here at the University of Winchester. I'm Sebastian Ferris, and I'm joined here in the studio by Brian Thornton, Chris Horry, and Edmund Scrivens to discuss the work of these two 19th century journalists, with production work by Andrew Giddings. The lecture given by Brian Thornton today looked at the tremendous social and economic changes that took place in the British Isles after the Napoleonic War, and how these were reflected in the journalism and literature of these times. Brian suggested that this was the period when everything we know came to the fore, a tale of two revolutions, as it were. How true is this, Brian?
I think it's a fair way to sort of introduce the subject of journalism in the 19th century. We have to consider that the French Revolution was a turning point in European history, but it was, people always summarized the period as being defined by the two revolutions: one, political in France, and the second, industrial in England. The Industrial Revolution was in some ways a response to the revolution in France. England was dragged into a war, into the Napoleonic War. At first was involved in paying for mercenaries to fight the war, and then eventually was involved directly with troops on the ground in France, and culminated in the victory in Waterloo. But what happened during the Napoleonic Wars was crucial. Britain became preeminent on the seas. The navy was had absolute power. Really, it controlled the waterways, and it blockaded the ports from France, so that France couldn't export. Their markets, their hold on the market was crushed. And into that void stepped England, stepped Britain, and it became dominant in its trade with America, South America, India, the Far East. It was this period where the British Empire started, while the European powers, the great European powers, were being drained and destroyed. In this sort of Napoleonic period, Britain was thriving, and it was boom time in England. They were supplying the army, and these massive new markets were opening up. During this time, Britain was building, it was building its empire in India, Singapore, South Africa. It was mainly on the back of what they call the transatlantic triangular trade, which was the transporting of slaves from Africa, and then taking cotton from the plantations in the South, the American South, bringing this cotton to places like Manchester and Bristol, Liverpool, where this cotton was then refined, and there was a finished product. Clothing was then exported to Africa, and so the triangle began again. So it was a time of intense change in England. It was a time of political change as well, because at this time Scotland was part of the Union. In 1801, Ireland became part of the Union, and it became the United Kingdom. There was a mass exodus from the land, from the countryside. People were driven from the land, really, because of the policy of enclosure. This was where landowners expanded the fields. Before this time, there was an idea of the common land. A landowner would have an area that was open to the local villagers, who would make this area free for villagers to use, so that they could their livestock could sort of graze there, and then it was possible for small farm owners to have a livelihood, to sort of sustain a family, to not live very, very well, but at least sort of keep off the breadline. But after the enclosures, the land, it was seen that because of this new machinery, big fields were needed, and they needed to get these smallholders off the land, enlarge the fields, And so these people were driven into the cities in their hundreds of thousands, so that the city swelled. And these cities weren't capable of taking this level of population. And so around the edges, they started to sort of crumble, and things like sanitation, infrastructure, these were just swamped by the number of people that came into the cities. People were, the two individuals we're talking about, were looking at the two different sides of this dramatic change. One was the COBBETT, who looked at the countryside, and two was Dickens, who looked at the urban sphere.
Brian, what were these particular cities like?
I mean, it was Dickens who looked at London. And it was his obsession, and this is the sort of the city that we think about when we're talking about the Industrial Revolution. But really, the centre of the Industrial Revolution was Manchester. Manchester, this incredible city, this modern city, the city that when people came to look at it, people from outside were just astonished. I mean, Chris, you're sort of an expert on this area of the Industrial Revolution. Is there anything you'd sort of like to add at this point?
Well, it's my hometown and my home city, and I grew up there. And in the 1960s, I was a child there, and it was an incredibly grim place. They were just starting to tear down the back-to-back housing. Essentially, this shanty town had grown up in one generation. At the end of the Napoleonic War, the population had gone from about 15,000 to 150,000. If you're scaling that up to the population of the British Isles now and the population of the world, that means a city of 50 million coming from nowhere. A pretty bleak part of the world anyway. It's always raining, moorlands, horrible. And not like the lovely Lake District or anything. It's those moors around there are really grim. And all these old Victorian buildings on it that were absolutely covered in soot. Because one thing about these cities was the extent to which they were polluted. In Bleak House, which we're reading, they describe these people whose job it is simply to sweep odour off the streets for fashionable ladies so they can cross the street. They would have to sweep all the crap out of the way. Unbelievably unhealthy. And I would see, going to see my grandparents in a particularly awful part of Salford, old women bent double with rickets and kind of chest diseases that they'd gotten as children around about the year 1880s. They would have been these old women whose lungs and chest had been completely destroyed by cotton, because Manchester was all about cotton spinning mills, and all these fibres, you know, kind of a bit like asbestosis, all these lung diseases. So you just, it was like hell. It was like hell on earth. And the only thing that was preserved or saved from those times was these churches, and there's dozens of these things, and they all look the same. They now haven't got any congregations. They're dreadful places with these spires covered in gargoyles and kind of black soot. It's the vision of L.S. Lowry, the only artist ever to come out of Manchester. Manchester is a place with almost no high culture whatsoever. We have this one artist, Lowry, who's dreadful. So that's Manchester. It was the workshop of the world, though. Briefly, there about 1850, it was the most important place on earth, really.
One of the most interesting aspects of this period was the sort of desperate attempt by the government to control these sort of colossal forces. One of the attempts that the government made was the Corn Laws. I think that Manchester in particular was sort of affected by the Corn Laws. Can you sort of explain why?
Well, that's right. Various civic monuments in Manchester, and the main civic thing is the Free Trade Hall. It's named after